HarperCollins presents Just Aspire. Notes on Technology, Entrepreneurship and the Future by Ajai Chowdhry, co-founder of HCL. Read by Ranjit Madgavkar. To the aspirational Indians, the millions who have the courage and self-belief to follow their dreams. Be our strength in hours of weakness. In our wanderings, be our guide. Through endeavor, failure, danger, Father, be thou at our side. A prayer, Christchurch Boys Senior Secondary School, Jabalpur. Author's note. I have had the privilege of spending 36 years of my life helping to create businesses within HCL, originally Hindustan Computers Limited. Today, HCL is a $10 billion corporation, and I am proud to have been a co-founder. When I left Jabalpur, the small town in Madhya Pradesh where I grew up, to pursue a career, I could not have dreamt that I would find myself at the vanguard of path-breaking revolutions that would transform India. My story is interleaved with my experiences and learnings at HCL. It is also about my life, pre and post HCL. In Jabalpur, I acquired the academic foundation and aspirational spirit that eventually led me to co-found HCL, where I helped shape India's PC revolution and later the revolution in mobile telephony. None of it would have been possible without the support of HCLers and the intrepid visionaries who founded HCL, the enigmatic and brilliant Shiv Nadar, who mentored and guided me throughout my career. The affable tech wizard Arjun Malhotra, sales virtuosos Yogesh Vaidya and Subhash Arora, and the insightful, irrepressible D.S. Pammi Puri. In the process of nudging India towards a knowledge economy, we co-founded the Manufacturers Association of Information Technology, MAIT. Then, to help create the right ecosystem to bring mobile phones to the masses, we co-founded the Indian Cellular Association, ICA, which played a significant role in enabling conducive rules for the growth of the industry, as well as reasonable product prices. As early as 1995, along with Nokia, we led the movement towards broad phone adoption by making them affordable, accessible, and repairable all over the country with breakthrough distribution strategies. Our success can be gauged from the fact that at one time, 70 out of 100 phones were Nokia/HCL. Today, the transformative effect of the telecom revolution across all sectors of the economy, not to mention its social and cultural impact, is self-evident. Parallel to this, I strove towards creating the Electronics System Design and Manufacturing, ESDM, industry in India. To that end, I have worked relentlessly since 1999 with doyens like N. Seshagiri and R. Chidambaram. As a member of several government committees, I've helped bring out a series of reports that found reflection in the breakthrough National Policy on Electronics 2019. The ESDM aspect of my work has picked up momentum in the last year with the creation of the EPIC Foundation, a non-profit organization that I have founded along with leading luminaries of the electronics hardware sector. It serves as a think tank for electronics and enables the growth of ESDM in India. I'm excited about the future of the industry, and I dream about making India an electronics product nation. Looking back, I feel that my success as a business leader is owed in large measure to the interdisciplinary mindset that I was encouraged to cultivate in my youth. My interests were wide and varied, spanning the spectrum from sports, music, and art to solid-state physics, software, and space technology, and this gave me a panoramic worldview and an ability to think laterally. Today, business leadership is increasingly about sifting for solutions from masses of data. It mandates an ability to connect the dots, one that has always come naturally to me, thanks to the plethora of whodunits I read, to the point where I can reflexively solve complex problems linked to management and technology. Wide-ranging knowledge enables you to step back and look at the big picture objectively, to see how the various components complement each other, and how they can be adjusted to improve the whole. The capacity to integrate learnings across seemingly unrelated domains and from a variety of people in different fields contributes to effective strategies. It is important to have passions outside the job, to keep the brain agile and the spirit humble with the knowledge that other people can outperform you in their respective fields. This motivates you to better yourself. To stop learning is to stop living. So I am constantly teaching, fostering innovation and nurturing talent, and in the process, reinventing myself, my skills, and my business. I have worn many hats. Entrepreneur, sportsman, salesperson, engineer, educationist, jazz aficionado, and consultant on population stabilizer. As an investor, I go from SaaS, software services, to pharma, from QSRs, quick service restaurants, to deep tech, and from furniture to space tech with equal ease. My journey from a small town boy to a CEO of a global company has enabled me to view the world from different angles and adapt to diverse environments. I've been as comfortable dining on the floor of a village hut as co-chairing the World Economic Forum in Africa. My advice? Never let your aspirations die or your passions dim, for they are the soul of entrepreneurship. Chapter 1. Jabalpur, the Wonder Years. Most boys get a dog for a pet. I had a tiger cub. My father, the then commissioner of Bundelkhand and Bagelkhand, gifted it to me when I was recovering from measles. Alas, the cub fell prey to the vagaries of India's malaria control program. While romping around the grounds of our sprawling bungalow in Rewa, it ingested a lethal dose of pesticide. For years, I couldn't think of my lost pet without a pang. There were other pets, rabbits, a deer, and the stray puppies gamboling around the servants' quarters of our home. Rewa, once a princely state known as the Land of the White Tiger, offered many amusements for a young boy, but very little by way of education. After my father, Jai Krishna Chowdhry, retired from the Indian Administrative Service in 1961, we moved to Jabalpur, which combined the gentle, laid-back ambiance of a small town with one of the finest educations India had to offer. Surrounded by highlands and nestled in the valley of the Narmada, the town had passed from Maratha to British rule in the early 19th century. It had multiple claims to fame: the fabulous Dhuadhar waterfall and Marble Rocks Gorge, Central India's first ordnance factory, GCF or gun carriage factory, and a rich history dating back to pre-Mauryan times. Jabalpur, or Jabalpur, as the British called it, expanded in the 20th century. The clement climate attracted a large migrant population. To this day, the names of many of its localities reflect the town's long colonial past, such as Lord Ganj, named for Governor General William Bentinck, and Maloney Gunj, Jones Gunj, and Napier Town, each named for a former British commissioner of Jabalpur. The cultural impact of the British was visible in the emphasis on, quote-unquote, an English education and an inclusive, open-minded social milieu. With its strong sense of community, relaxed pace of life, access to amenities, and high standard of education, Jabalpur was an idyllic setting for my journey through boyhood and adolescence. We stayed at Sarguja House while my father negotiated the purchase of his retirement home in Napier Town, appropriately named Ashiana, or Nest. Fortuitously, he was offered a 2-year extension and the post of Jabalpur Municipal Commissioner, which he accepted with alacrity. The decision to settle in Jabalpur followed naturally from my father's long stint in Madhya Pradesh, and the fact that, as a partition refugee, he had no home to which he could return. His family was originally from Tank in the northwest frontier province, carved out of British Punjab in 1901, now Khyber Pakhtunkhwa in Pakistan, the rolling tract between the Hindu Kush mountains and the plains of Punjab, has long served as a confluence of cultures, having been ruled by Persians, Greeks, Mauryans, Sikhs, British, and finally the sovereign state of Pakistan. At the time my father was born, Indian nationalism was charting a new destiny for the subcontinent. As a young man, his first karmabhumi, land where he worked, was Abbottabad, where he set up a thriving practice as a criminal lawyer. The family lived in a beautiful house opposite the Abbottabad Club, framed by tall poplars with white rose bushes wreathing the large veranda. The library was well stocked with books in Persian, Urdu, and Sanskrit, apart from the vast array of legal volumes my father needed for his work. A fervent nationalist, he joined the freedom struggle and became the president of the Hazara District Congress Committee. Partition was a shattering blow. Overnight, Jai Krishna Chowdhury, the freedom fighter, became a nameless refugee. Abbottabad to Abu. At the urging of well-wishers, the family boarded the last train from Pakistan, fleeing with the clothes on their backs, clinging to the hope that partition would be short-lived and they would return in due course. The train left from Haripur at dawn. The coaches were jam-packed, with hundreds perched precariously on the roofs. It was a journey fraught with terror. Frenzied mobs on either side of the rail track were baying for their blood. Thousands had already perished in the infamous blood trains ferrying refugees to India, and but for the contingent of brave Gurkha soldiers on board, this bunch of passengers would also have been slaughtered. My grandmother did not survive that horrific journey. She passed away just as the train arrived at Firozpur cantonment. Here the Sutlej River, mirroring the turmoil of the times, overflowed, causing a terrible flood. As the waters receded, cholera stalked the refugee camps. My parents made their way to Delhi, where they found a home of sorts in premises vacated by a coal and scrap merchant who had departed for Pakistan. It was a grimy, noxious hellhole, located 6 kilometers from the Viceroy's house, now Rashtrapati Bhavan. Fortunately, my father found employment as assistant commandant of the Kingsway camp for refugees, helping other displaced people find their feet. His performance was noted with appreciation, and he was appointed assistant regional commissioner of the Rajputana states, tasked with persuading the princes to sign the instrument of accession and integrate with the Republic of India before 26 January 1950. He was posted at Mount Abu, where I was born, in August 1950. in a lavish bungalow called The Wilderness, overlooking the Nakki Lake. The youngest of seven children and the second boy, I was the pink-cheeked, chubby little apple of the family's eye. Senior officials of the British Raj had enjoyed a luxurious lifestyle, which the Chowdhry family inherited. With the bungalow came a large staff, including a cook, masal cheese or spice blenders, numerous bearers, a dhobi or washerman, and several others with miscellaneous jobs. Soon after, while I was still an infant, my father was posted to Jaipur. His ardent nationalism had survived the rigors of partition, and he wanted to play a role in establishing the sovereign Republic of India on firm footing. To that end, he applied to the Indian Administrative Service, IAS, the successor to the Indian Civil Service, ICS, whose British members had been repatriated. His education and administrative experience made him an ideal candidate, and after 9 months of training at the Metcalf House Academy in Jaipur, he joined the first batch of the IAS at the age of 45. Allotted the Vindhya Pradesh cadre, he was sent to Jabalpur for 9 months of field training before being posted as district magistrate of Shahdol, a heavily forested tribal area. Electricity had yet to reach this remote district, so the DM's bungalow had no power, and hence no electrical gadgets, not even fans. Tarred roads were non-existent, and sanitation was decidedly old school, thunder boxes rather than water closets. It was hard on my older siblings, but I, as a three-year-old, was more concerned with escaping their attempts to teach me the alphabet so that I could ride my tricycle. Frustrated, my sister Sneha would lock me up in the bathroom. If the objective was to frighten me into learning my ABCs, it failed. Even as a toddler, I had a sanguine temperament. They would invariably find me sitting calmly on the bathroom floor, waiting to be let out. That innate composure, which I owe to the stable emotional environment created by my family, has proved invaluable throughout my life. I have pleasant, if rather vague, memories of our next home in Naugaon. My father was Divisional Commissioner of Bundelkhand, so we lived in a fabulous British residency, which had 6 bedrooms with attached bathrooms, a darbar hall, a vast chandelier dining room, a swimming pool, a summer house and tennis courts. After Shahdol, it was a veritable paradise. The previous incumbent seemed to have departed precipitously, as he left behind a fully equipped home, right down to a dinner service and library. It was an estate in itself, with orchards, fields, outhouses and acres of lawn. One of my sisters was married there, and the guests, I imagine, must have been suitably impressed by the venue. Jawaharlal Nehru and the Phatphati. A few months after we had settled into Naugaon, Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru and his daughter Indira came to dinner. Nehru's interest in the development of Khajuraho as a tourist destination is well documented. He declared his desire to see the temple complex, which was part of my father's jurisdiction. Ahead of the visit, my father undertook a preparatory tour of the area. Captain T.S. Burt had rediscovered the Chandela temple complex dating from the 9th to 11th century CE in 1838. He brought it to the attention of eminent archaeologists such as Sir Alexander Cunningham. But when my father saw the site over a century later, he found it utterly neglected, overgrown with vegetation and encrusted in bat guano. So foul were the interiors of the temples that one couldn't stand there without holding one's breath.
He initiated a mammoth effort to clean it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.